Klinkt wel heftig. Hey guys, and welcome to another episode of Digital Classroom. We are waiting for a YouTube to catch up and of course Facebook as soon as we see the go. That's actually when we start. So YouTube is live at the moment. Do we have Facebook, Henrik? Facebook is live. Awesome. Guys, welcome in our studio in Emmeloord in the Netherlands. It's a little bit chilly, but we're gonna have a really hot show today because we are using very hot lighting. Hot lighting, tungsten lighting, whatever kind of lighting. Do you think you need strobes? Watch this episode of Digital Classroom. But before we start, let's make sure that you know what you're looking at. So, are you ready? One, two, go. Okay guys, welcome in the studio in Emmeloord. So one of the most asked questions probably is, and I just realized that I do a lot of the most asked questions, but you know there are so many questions that just come back over and over again. And without a doubt, one of those questions is not really a question. It's more like an attitude. So when I do a workshop, there's always this one person that goes like, yeah, Frank, I really like what you're doing here, but... And you know that everything before but is totally bullshit. So if somebody says, hey man, I really like how you're looking, I love your hair, I love your clothing, but forget everything that was before but, because that was a lie. Everything that's after but, that's what's happening. So most of the time it's like, but my lens is not good enough, or but my lighting is not good enough, or but I don't have a good studio. The thing is that creativity and especially lighting is all here. It's not about strobes, it's not about very fancy lighting. Now, I love my Hensel strobes, don't get me wrong. Hensel is without a doubt my workhorse. That's what I use a lot. Now, when you look at creativity with strobes, it isn't that simple, but it isn't also that hard. Because in other words, you just have your strobes, you have a lot of power, so you can do whatever you want. You have modifiers like strip lights, beauty dishes, grids, whatnot more. You have so many creative tools. Now, when you go to speed lights, for example, or small flash, you find that a lot of people are struggling a little bit more. They go like, yeah, but now I have these small strobes. Well, you can use the same modifiers. You have strip lights, you have flash benders, of course, Rogue Expo Imaging, awesome products with the snoots, with the flash benders. So there are a lot of those accessories for your small strobes. And now you go like, okay, Frank, but I don't have any money at all. I just want to start out with model photography. I want to make some portraits. What can I do with absolutely no money? And then they look at me and they start smiling like, you don't have an answer for that, right? And I always go like, yeah, that's possible. And today it's all about what's possible. Today we are going to talk about, and not talk, we're going to do a live shoot, of course. We're going to talk about using light sources that are incredibly cheap, that are in almost every household for the first set, and light sources that you already have with you, already in your pocket without knowing it. There are some limitations, of course. So today, because we're shooting with tungsten light sources and with LED lighting, we do have to lower the light in the studio. So it means that now you see me correctly. When we do the live shoot in the studio in a few moments, you will see that we dim the lights and it will be very hard for you guys to see what we're doing. However, don't worry, you will see the images coming in on Capture One, so it's a split screen. So just ignore the part that's on the lower part. We still keep it running because you do see some stuff happening, but don't put in the comments like, hey, get some proper lighting. The reason we don't use proper lighting at the moment, and normally we have the LEDCO panels, of course, in our studio. What's wrong?
No.
Oh, okay. So when somebody taps, I always think like, hey, I do something wrong. No. So that's my cue. Anyway, so when you look at the LED lighting in our studio, which we normally use, they emit a lot of light. Now, when we start using the tungsten light sources, everything that is also emitting light will actually interfere with what I want to show you guys. So that's why today in the studio, we're going to turn off all the lighting and only focus on those lightings. So guys, grab your phones, turn it on, put it on silent. Are you ready to start? Grab some popcorn, because we have Claudia here today and very hot light. So maybe if you put your popcorn in front of your monitor, it will start to pop. Yeah, that was a very bad joke, I know, sorry. Anyway, so we have two chat rooms open. We have the chat room on YouTube open. You can ask whatever you want. We also have Super Chat, where you have to pay to ask me a question. Don't use Super Chat. It's a waste of money because I will answer you anyway. And if you want to support our work, it's way easier. Go to Patreon or just whatever, buy some of our instructional videos. I will show you very quickly, I will do that later, where you can go to Patreon. And let me see, it's actually this part. So patreon.com/FrankDorhoff starts at €1 a month or $1 a month, and you really support our work. So don't use the super chat from YouTube, because we're fully licensed, how do you call it? Affiliate. We can use the super chat, but guys, don't. It's just costs you money. Okay, so today our model is Claudia. And Claudia is, of course, an awesome model. And we are using our new backdrops in the studio from Click Prop Backdrops. See, I practiced, so now I can pronounce it without breaking my tongue. Anyweek is actually running at the moment Facebook. So if you are watching on Facebook, hello. And make sure that you also leave comments there. Everything that you guys ask will be incorporated into the live stream. So that means that if you have a question, don't ask anything about strobes today, of course. You can ask it, but I can't incorporate that. But if you have any questions, or if you think this goes really, really fast, Frank, slow down, just let me know and we'll slow down or we'll answer your questions. So, Claudia, are you ready?
Yes.
I am ready too. So let's go to our studio and let's do some shooting. Let me switch over the camera first. There we go. Okay. So you can already see that we have our beautiful backdrop from Click Prop Backdrops, which we actually distribute in the Netherlands and Benelux at the moment. So if you want a beautiful backdrop, make sure you contact Anouk or me. Let's turn on the camera. And before I do anything, I'm going to explain some stuff to you guys, of course. Yeah, I know I have to be in the picture, Anouk. Don't worry. So, okay, Claudia, are you ready? Yes, see her smile. She's always smiling.
Mm-hmm.
Until you see me, of course, then. Okay, can you stand in front of the backdrop? Now, the first thing you have to realize is that when we do a photo shoot, there's always light. Now, light behaves universally, and it's called the inverse square law. That means that the further you place your light away, the faster the light fall off is, or less light fall off. Did you think about that? Okay. The more you move your light closer to the model, the faster the light will fall off. So that means that if you place a light source really far away, you get a lot of spread of that light, but you don't get something that's really exciting. You get more like an overall look. Like you see now, we have a LED panel about, I think, 5 meters away from our model. It's a very flat light. It isn't that interesting, to be totally honest. It looks a little bit bland. Some people will like it. I don't. So let's just try a very simple household product. It's called a light bulb. So, very simple thing. Let's plug it in. Hans, can you plug it in? We have Hans here today, who's helping me out. Oh, there we go. What a bright light, right? Do you like the bright light? You're not a gremlin, right? No, because gremlins don't like bright light. Let me just grab a camera. I don't need any triggers today. So that's cool. Okay, so I have my camera here. It's the Sony a7 R4, and this is actually a force of nature, this camera. It's really fast, 60 megapixels files. But you know the problem with cameras? If they don't perform well with low lighting, it's cool for the studio, but not on location. And this camera performs really well for low lighting, and you're going to see that today. But the lens choice is a little bit different. My normal weapon of choice is the G-Master 24-70 2.8. Today I'm actually shooting with a very old Minolta lens. It's a 50mm 1.4. You can get them on eBay or Marktplaats or Craigslist or whatever you're watching. And they retail for about €100. The only thing you need is an LIA converter. So that's here in the middle. And this is the one with a mirror. You have one of the converters without a mirror and one with. The older one, the older lenses, they only work on the ones with the mirror, because there's also a motor inside which actually focuses the lens. So make sure that when you buy something like this, you get the one with the mirror. And I'm looking for you guys if it's the LIA 3 or 4. And so quickly I can't find it. Maybe in the break, or if somebody wants, we'll put it in the comments below. But you have the LIA 4 and the LIA 3. And I think this is the 4, but anyway, the one with the mirror. Okay, can you stand against the wall, please? And let's take one picture with the LED lighting on, so I didn't change anything. That's my light bulb, very far away. We'll take one picture. The cool thing about today is we don't need any light meters because we're just shooting on aperture priority. So let's change that. I want my ISO to be auto. So let's change that to auto. There we go. And there's one more thing I have to change in my menu. And that's actually that I want to see what I get. Now, Sony has a really cool option. It's called setting effect. And setting effect will actually make sure that on your display, you will see what happens. I get a lot of questions about this by people that buy a Sony camera or any mirrorless camera. They go into the studio and they just can't take any picture because, well, the display is black. The reason the display is black, because you're shooting f16, 125th ISO 100. That doesn't work, right? Because then it's supposed to be black. By turning off that setting effect or emulation, you will actually have a camera that behaves like a normal optical viewfinder. For today, I have to do it the other way around, because today I'm not shooting strobes, I'm actually shooting constant lighting. And then you need to see what you're doing. So in this case, let's just aim at our model, take a picture. And the moment you see the picture coming in, you will see that it's okay. It's not really bad. It has a terrible, terrible color hue. We're gonna fix that later. But it's also not something where you go like, hey Frank, I love this episode of Digital Classroom. The first image was awesome. Actually, the first image sucks terribly because it just looks terrible. And why does it look terrible? The first thing is that my light bulb is still far away from our model. The second thing is, of course, we still have a LED panel on. So Hans, can you turn off the LED panel? And Annewiek, are you in split screen?
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, so let's see the difference now. Can you look a little bit that way? I immediately see that she has way more shadow on her nose. So this is with only the light bulb. And as you can see now, we have a more distinct shadow side. And it's okay. But still, when I look at this picture, I go like, oh man, this looks really, really, really bad. And why is that? There is no contrast. It's a very unflattering light source. I have a beautiful model, so why? You might wonder, why not use a strobe? Well, because today we're not using strobes. But let's just change the light bulb to a little bit further away from where it is now, so a little bit closer to our model. So I'm gonna lift this up, and I'm gonna place it really next to our model. Like here. You're used to the light bulbs, right? We have a beautiful image of her, I think a year ago, with a light bulb. Can you look down? Okay, now I'm using my contrast a little bit, like I would normally do with strobes. And here you go, you have a way more interesting shot, but it's still a little bit boring. And why is it boring? Well, we have a bright backdrop, we have a model that's there, and the light is actually also hitting the backdrop. So what you can do is block that light off and make sure that it doesn't hit that backdrop. How? You can use flags or what not more. Yes, Annewiek.
There's something selected, I guess.
Oh. Oh, there's a red spot. Yes, I know what that is. One moment. You have to press Ctrl E in Capture One. Let me do that very quickly.
It's a sharpening mask or something?
No. Let me do that very quickly. Oh, view exposure warning. There we go. It actually showed that it was a little bit overexposed. Okay, just for fun, because you guys are seeing it on camera, if you block it off with, for example, a flag, sorry, I was out of the frame, you can get a little bit more contrast on your model by just placing, for example, a flag just behind her. Let me do it from the other side. And make sure that it's out of the frame when you take the picture. But this way, you can channel it towards your model. And for example, like this. But this light is very, very close to our model, so we're not going to do that. We're going to do something else. By moving my light source, let's say in front, I'm getting a little bit more of a flat look, but also a little bit like a butterfly. So watch this. Can you look straight into the camera? Chin down a little bit. There we go, chin up. Awesome. Okay, this looks a little bit better. But overall, we still have that nasty shadow, right? Okay. Can you move your head a little bit that way?
Can I do this?
Yes, sure. Just move your head that way. Awesome. There we go. That's cool.
Nice. And even a little bit further away. And as you can see, the images aren't that bad yet. We can get better. Better. You know what I mean, right? So let's say that you have something like this and your client goes like, yeah, I like it, Frank, but. And there's always that but, you know? So he doesn't like it. He wants it more flat lighting, a little bit more like a beauty dish or a softbox. Is that possible? Well, how do you create soft lighting? You create soft lighting by using diffusion, right? Because as soon as you put something that's harsh to diffusion, you will get it more soft. That can be smoke. Don't worry, we're not going to use smoke. It can be something like a reflector. Hey, there we go, a reflector. Now, did you ever buy a 5-in-1 reflector? It has, yes, silver, gold, black, white, and where's the fifth? The fifth is actually in the middle. That's a diffusion panel. So we actually have one over here. And they're very cheap. And two. Okay, guys, we have to switch batteries really fast. One moment. We will be right back. Don't go anywhere because my model is still there. So let's just switch over. Okay, I'm going to switch batteries now, so we're going to be quiet for a second. One, two. Okay, I think we have audio back, so let's make sure that we have enough volume. Okay. One, two. Okay, if I'm correct, you guys can hear me now again.
Yeah.
Awesome. Okay, sorry guys. We had two blocks before we started, but it went really fast. That's one of the main disadvantages of rechargeable batteries. We think about the environment, but sometimes it also means that we lose a little bit of time, and sometimes they just quit on us. Okay, how is the audio quality now? It's not clipping? Okay, let me check. One moment, guys, sorry. Okay, let me just sit here behind the desk for a second and let me figure out what's going on. One, two. One, two, one, two. Okay, I think the audio is a lot better now. Okay, let me see if guys are... Okay. Annemie, can you check on Facebook how the audio is? Sorry guys, we are working on it. Don't worry. Okay, is that better? One, two. Okay, we're just going to continue with this. I think it's going to be...
It looks great.
I think it's going to be good. Okay. So if the audio is a little bit too soft, guys, just let us know. Now it's getting a lot louder. Okay, guys, I don't know what's going on. It seems like now we're over. Really? Okay, 1, 2, 1, 2. This should be perfect. Now we're back at the beginning. Maybe it's like an auto-leveling system or whatever. Okay, so, sorry guys. Yeah, that's why we love doing live broadcast. Okay, so the more I close the diffusion panel towards the light source, the smaller my light source will get. The more I move the diffusion panel away from my light source, the bigger the light source will get. So that means that you have a tremendous amount of power in this case with your, well, in essence it's a softball. So let's just first show you an image where it's really close to the material. Like it's now maybe 10 centimeters away. It's a little bit different. So now you can see that we have a way softer image quality. It wraps around our model much nicer. And we have almost like a softbox effect. Now, if we want that a little bit more, the only thing you have to do is move that light source further away. It will lower, of course, also in intensity. It looks a little bit more different. Perfect. It's a lot darker. And now look at that shadow part on her chin. You see that now that side is also a little bit lit up. The thing is, however, the image is a little bit darker, and that has to do with the metering system inside the camera. It's too soft audio. Okay, we're going to try it again. One moment. Okay, 1, 2. Let me try it one up. Is the audio better now?
No, it
shouldn't be clipping, and it is almost clipping. This is way too loud, but if that works, I'm fine. Okay, so how do we set everything up? The thing is that when it's a little bit too dark, and because I'm shooting on AV mode and auto ISO, my camera actually determines everything. My camera makes sure that I get a proper exposure, right? But when I look at the picture, I don't see proper exposure. And one of the things that immediately triggers my mind is the backdrop. The backdrop is pretty bright. So that means that my metering system in the camera will actually not just look at our model, but will actually look at the total scene. So what we're going to do is we're actually going to use, very simple, our exposure compensation. So I'm going to go to 1.4 up, full stop up. Now this will be way too bright, as you can see here. But you see that with exposure compensation, because we're shooting with constant lighting, so our shutter speed also is a part of that setup, I can actually use my exposure compensation to literally just dial in what I like. And because I'm shooting with the Sony, I can actually see exactly what I'm doing. That's awesome. Nice. And you see, I'm constantly coaching my model and saying she's doing fine, she's doing awesome. Don't overact it. Okay, let's do a little bit more of your cloning. Nice, love it. Okay, now get the really cool lens flare effect in. On the sides, as you can see, you can be really creative with this kind of stuff. And the lighting effect, of course, comes from the diffusion panel that actually reflects a little bit of that light bulb. You don't need any special effects for that. As you can see, I really like that effect. And I can lay it over my model to make it a little bit more funky. Or I can turn my camera and make it a little bit less wide. Or move it the other way around. I hope you guys can see the lens flaring capture on. I'm just playing a little bit. Awesome. And if you don't want it, no problem. I'm just going to move this a little bit this way. And at that point, I'm really blocking my light away from my camera. And now it's gone. But I actually liked it with it. But hey, we got enough images now, I think. Oh, that's nice. Do that one more time. Let's get that lens flare in again. There we go. Awesome. Okay, final shot. Okay, let's see what we can do with this in Photoshop, and then we're going to do something that's even cooler. We're going to use a light source that you already have in your pocket. But first, let's go into Photoshop and let the model just change clothes and masks. Okay, is the audio correct now?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, awesome.
But because there's a delay, it takes a while.
I did forget one very, very important thing. I need my color checker for this. Yes. Okay. So let's do the color checker. Oh, you don't need to pose for this. Just hold it in front of your face and make a funny face. Aim it towards the light. 1, 2. There we go. Awesome. Yep, that one is going into the books. Okay. So let's recap a little bit because we had a lot of audio trouble. So let me switch cameras to me. Okay, there we go. And let's go to the big monitor. Okay, so what we did is we actually used a very simple household light bulb. The light bulbs that you all know, this is, I believe, a 50 or 100 watt light bulb. Nowadays, you can also use LED lighting. The thing is, you have to have a lot of light output. Because you are working with a little bit of light, your camera is very sensitive for light, so that means that it needs as much light as possible. So make sure that if you do something like this, don't go for the 25 watt light bulb. Get the brightest one you can get. You will love me for it. And your mother will probably hate you for it. But hey, getting it a little bit better is by using light that emits a little bit more light. Now, when you look at the color, you will see that when I do a photo shoot in Capture One or Lightroom or wherever, I always have a profile in place. And in Capture One, you can actually say that the next image that comes in takes over the color from the previous image, like, for example, color balance or color profiling. Now, normally that's not a real problem for me, but when I'm shooting with tungsten light sources, you get a light source that's way hotter. So in color temperature, it's lower, but it has a more red hue. So that means that we have to take that out. And this is actually where the color checker comes in. So let me just do this very quickly. One moment. Let me just take this one down. Okay. Switch over to split screen. Okay, guys, can you let me know if the audio is better now? Or if it's still clipping? Because I can do it a little bit lower on the mixer. I think this is much better. Okay, let me see here. I am checking the audio a little bit, guys. I don't want to fall off again. Okay, so the first thing is you can, of course, build a profile in Capture One with the X-Rite software. But in essence, let's just do it simple for today. And the same goes in Lightroom or Capture One or Exposure software or whatever software you use. There's always this picker called a white balance picker. Now you go to your X-Rite color checker passport and you just pick one of these three gray patches. Don't use white and don't use black. You see that there's no change. Oh, a little bit. Look at the backdrop. And the reason is very simple. If you go to black, there's a lot of noise. And the chance that I'm actually picking something that also has a little bit of noise is there. If you go to white, it might very well be that one of the color channels is clipped. So we see three colors, red, green and blue. In the digital system, it actually dictates that your color stops at 254. Some people say 255, I don't care, it's one number. But somewhere at the 254, it will clip. And it means that if you use the white one, and for example, the green channel is clipped, the green channel will actually register as 254, while in essence, it could be 270. So that's why we always use a gray patch that's a little bit lower than white and a lot higher than black, because we don't want noise, but we don't want the chance that one of our color channels is clipped. So I now made a correction. Today it's not about tungsten light sources per se. It's about what you can do with a different light source if you don't have a strobe. So let's do the adjustments, copy and apply. Now the reason I say it is sometimes you want that color to be different. So, for example, if you shoot with candles or if you shoot a sunset, you don't want that color to be neutral. You actually want that color to be the color of that sunset or the color of that light bulb. So that's why we're doing it like this. Okay, so we started out with a very simple LED light. And now look at the difference, actually. When you look at this image, you can see that there's a little bit of a magenta cast in there. Now, as soon as we start over, do you see how much influence that LED panel actually has? So when you do stuff like this, make sure you do it like we did before in a pitch dark studio. No extra lighting. Okay, let's see what we like. So this is way too dark under our eyes. I like this because when you use a mask, You don't see the eyes, so it can be dark. I love this shot, but I know there are better ones. Ooh, this one is cool. I really like this. And it's sharp. Okay, let's give this, for now, 5 stars. This is okay, you know, but it's a little bit too simple. No, don't like this at all. This is okay. No. Okay. Nothing spectacular yet. There we go. I love this lens flare over here. And again, it also helps the lens. When I do this with the 24-70 2.8 G Master from Sony, I won't get those lens flares because that lens is so well coated. And sometimes you just want those lens flares in. The disadvantage is, especially when you look at the eyes, focus is hit and miss with this lens, especially on 1.4. There is focus, it is sharp, but it's not a lens that's razor sharp wide open, but it's not about that today. So next set I will probably shoot on 2.8 when I see this. And this is one of the things, by the way, if you get a modern lens from Sony, or I love the Sigma Art lenses, for example, you will get razor sharp images even on 1.4. So maybe for the next one, I'm actually going to use the 35mm from Sigma. I think that's even a better choice. But this lens, when you stop it down to 2.8, it's awesome. Okay, let me see if we have something interesting here. I actually love those last images with the lens flare. Look at this. This is awesome. Let's select this one. Ah, and that was actually that last image. Awesome. Okay, let's go back to the front. Now, we have 2 images that I really like. This one. And let me first do it. We're going to do it basics, right? No Photoshop at all. Right? You don't have any budget, so you don't have Photoshop. Then why should you have Capture One? I don't know. It's just... Okay, let's pull back the highlights. Give a little bit of shadow detail, add a little bit of contrast, and there you go, there you have your first shot. Is it sharp? It's okay. Okay, now, of course, when you look at the shot like this, you go like, hey Frank, normally you use all these amazing filters like exposure software, DxO film pack, Luminar. Can we also do something like this in Capture One or Lightroom? Yes, you can. You always have to remember that every filter, most of the filters, do stuff that you can emulate in Photoshop. That's not 100% true, by the way. Some filters are just freaking awesome and they do totally different stuff. But most of the looks, the film emulations, you can emulate in Photoshop, but it takes you a lot of time. Capture One is a very, very elaborate program, and you can do some of those looks there. Now, I already told you guys that we only see 3 colors, red, green, and blue. That, remember those color channels? Those channels you can also find in your curve. So when you look here, and this is the same in Lightroom, when you see Luma, that's actually your total curve, you see a red, green, and blue. Now, if you want to create something like a little bit of a vintage look, what I always do is I first go to the red channel, and I will determine, do I want more red in the shadows or less? In this case, I think a little bit less. So I'm going to pull red out of the shadows. There we go, it's already turning blue. And then add a little bit in the highlights for skin tone. Let's get that back. There we go. So now you already have a vintage look, right? It's not that difficult. But let's go back. So reset the curve. In Capture One, and this is one of the things that I love about Capture One, and I never saw this in other software, we have levels. And levels works totally different from other software that I use. So we still have red, green, and blue. Now don't worry if you can't do this, if you don't have Capture One, just do it with curves. But I think this is a little bit better. Now I can also use my midpoint, and I can actually just shift this around until I see what I like. So this is too blue. So what I do is here I actually take that red up, and here I take it down. There you go. And now it seems like it's the original image, but it's still totally different. Because when I reset it, you can see that slight U is gone. So bring that U in. There we go. Make fine tune it. And then maybe also for the shadows, add a little bit of red. There we go. Love this. Then do the same thing for blue. Add a little bit of blue. Take it away in the highlights to make it yellow. In this case, I don't want it. So add a little bit. There we go. And in the shadows, same thing. I don't want more. I want less. There we go. So now we have a totally different look than before. So when I reset this, you see that there. It's very subtle, but it's there. So edit, undo. There we go. Okay, now we're going to fine-tune this. So I'm going to do a little bit more contrast. A little bit saturation. OK, Okay. And we can go actually into color temperature. And I'm going to do something else. Now, of course, we already did the white balance, right? But with white balance, you can also play. And a lot of people don't get this. Like, why do you use color checkers? Why do you use white balance cards if you're going to play with the looks? The thing is, if I store this as a preset, every time I shoot with a color checker and I first do my color balance, I can run that preset and get exactly the same look over and over again. So you don't have to do this different times. You just do it once, you store it as a preset, and you're done. So I'm going to change now the color temperature. And I want to make it more blue, like a little bit of a Gotham-like look. And add a little bit of tint here. There you go. Go back to curves. Let me see curves. There we go. And just add a little bit of contrast. And there you go. So as you can see, I didn't leave my raw converter. Everything is done in the raw converter. And this is another but. I don't have software. Any software will do. As long as you have levels and curves, it's fine. And every raw converter, even the raw converter that came free with your camera, you can do this stuff. So no more excuses. Okay, now let's go to this one. This one we're going to do in Photoshop. So let's go to Photoshop. And let's do both, just for fun. Control D. Let's go to Photoshop. Now, some people might say, like, hey, Frank, you have this little... you can't see my hands. You have this little thing from your diffusion panel there. Do you take that out? No. I leave that in. I actually think it adds a little bit to this shot because it's round and also my lens flare is round. Now, if that lens flare wasn't in there, I may just crop the shot a little bit to make sure that I don't see that reflector part. But for this case, I'll just leave it in. Okay, this one I will just close. Okay. So, first things first, let's look at the skin. And in my opinion, if a skin is correct, don't mess around with it. And Claudia has really good skin. And as you can see here, this lens isn't the sharpest in the bunch. But it has a nice soft look. Let's call it that. Always be positive. It's a really cheap lens, guys. Okay, so when I look at a shot like this, the only thing I actually find out that I can do more in Photoshop is actually enhance it a little bit more. So let's go into my favorite plugin without any doubt. And that's, of course, Exposure Software, Exposure 5. Now, in the past, this was called Alien Skin Exposure. And last Digital Classroom, I already messed up a lot by calling it Alien Skin Exposure. I tried, and I still make that mistake sometimes. It's just too much embedded in my DNA. But it's called Exposure Software now. And the first one I hit, I already love. And this is one of the things that I love about this software package. I now already have one that I like. I don't have to plug in any other ones. I just hover over them and it will take on that colors. Ooh, look at this. This is a really nice one. And this is the original. Yeah, there we go. Love this. Maybe black and white. It's okay. Normally when an image isn't that sharp, I always make it black and white, add a lot of contrast and noise, and you have instant art. But in this case, we're just going to leave it like this. I actually like this. So let's pull down the highlights a little bit. There we go. Add a little bit of contrast. Awesome. And maybe a little bit. Oh, that's way too much. There we go. Vibrance a little bit up. And saturation a little bit down. This might seem weird. But vibrance doesn't make images, or sorry, colors clip. Saturation does. By adding a little bit of vibrance and pulling down the saturation, you get a really nice balance that I love. Okay. Now, because I'm in Exposure Software, the cool thing I can do here is play with every single channel. Now, when you look in Lightroom or any other software again, make sure that when you use something like this, you use your ASL. Now, what is HSL? HSL is your color management. It's called Hue, Saturation, and Luminance. Every color is part of a three-dimensional color space. We have Hue, Saturation, and Luminance. Luminance and saturation is a little bit connected to each other, and Hue is more like a skew. So when you look at the triangle, you can shift red towards green or towards blue, depending on where it has to be. Your saturation is away from your white point, and your luminance is your three-dimensionality, how saturated a color looks. Now, when you look at here at your HSL settings, you can actually see that for every color, red, oranges, yellows, greens, cyans, blues, purples, and magenta, I actually have a slider for Hue, Saturation, and Luminance. And that's awesome, because now I can literally change everything about my image that I want to change. So let's say that I love that red look here. And I want to enhance that a little bit. You can, of course, use saturation. But the problem is, as soon as you use saturation, you get that oversaturated look. That like, yeah, we saw that before. Don't do it with saturation. What you better can do is, because there's also some of that red in the skin, is just take your luminance and pull it down. And as you can see now, you get a way different look in your reds. The reds look more saturated, but they aren't. Because you lower the lumosity, you will actually not get that oversaturated look, but still that look is a little bit darker. And now you can finish it off with just a hinge of saturation. And there you go. Okay, let's see. I like the blues. So let's make a 1-4-5. If you're a musician, you get that joke. If you don't worry. Okay, let me explain. 1-4-5 is the chord progression for blues. So anyway. Okay, let's change the U just a little bit for that blue. There we go. Love it. Okay, I think this is okay. Let's see a before and after. Yep, love it. Apply. And there you go. So overall, just a light bulb and a diffusion panel, nothing more. And you saw even that without that diffusion panel, the light bulb already looks pretty awesome. Okay, this is a really intense filter, so it takes a little while to render. And we also have a little bit of grain in there, I saw, so that's why it takes a little bit. Okay, now when I see it, I go like, yeah, it looks absolutely awesome, but I need my opacity down because it's way too saturated. And this is where we have to stop. Hold on. This is weird. Why do I just make my setup? It comes in and I say, okay, let's put the saturation down. This is something that's very, very important for you guys. I'm going to pick up the camera. I'm going to show you exactly what I mean. Now, when you look at my Cintiq, this is where I actually do all my drawing on, you will see that it shows you a totally different look from that monitor. Now, it's very hard to see because it's very dark, but this is the Cintiq, and that's a BenQ monitor. Now, the thing is, and a lot of people don't realize this, the Cintiq is awesome to draw on. It's a really good drawing tablet. It's absolutely awesome. But for color reproduction, or if you really want to see how much shadow detail there is, how much white detail there is, what the color is actually doing, the Cintiq is great, but it's not perfect. So that's why we always have on top a BenQ monitor where I run Navigator. I'm going to show you very quickly how you can do that. So let's go back to split screen. Let me go here. Okay. So on top, on the other monitor, what you already saw was actually this Window Navigator. And normally Navigator you will find up here. And it's really, really small. It's like a postamp. What a lot of people don't know, it just undock Navigator, drag it to a separate monitor and just pull it out completely. And you have a full screen preview on a calibrated monitor. So when I retouch, and I'm doing retouching, I'm doing like this. As soon as I do color, I'm doing it like this. So this is very important to know. Okay, so let's turn the opacity down just a little bit, but I'm not going to look at the Cintiq, I'm actually going to look at the BenQ. This is too much. Zero, and then just build it up to hero. And there we go. And when I look at the Cintiq, this is way too saturated. When I look at the BenQ, I go like, it's on the edge, so it's perfect. Okay, let's do a layer flatten image, and let's do one more thing. Now, when you look at this image, it's okay, it's cool, but, everything before but, right? When you look at her dress, I think it can need a little bit more of a oomph. Two ways to do it. You can make a duplicate copy, go here for your dodge tool, and just go over the highlights. There you go. So before, after. I really like this. Okay, let's do another trick. Layer, new layer, go to soft light, fill with neutral gray. You don't have that option if you don't use soft light or hard light or whatever. Soft light works best. Now I have a layer that does absolutely nothing. And the cool thing is with this layer, I can actually take a white brush and everything that I now touch, and don't put it on 100%, will actually get a little bit more light. You can really open up shadow areas that way. Or give a little bit of an accent. There we go. Before, after. And this was the one with the dodge tool. The dodge tool is a little bit more subtle, I think this one is better. Okay, so layer, flatten image. But just, you know, just learn them both. And you have a perfect arsenal. Okay, file, close. And yes. Okay. And let's go for the second set. But before we do that, we have a video out called Any Light Will Do. And that's actually exactly what we're doing here. The reason we're showing these videos is not because we want to upsell something. We love it if you guys buy it. But it's because we have to set up the second set for the very simple reason. So we need a little bit of a break. So I will show you a video about a video that's an awesome video if you want to do stuff like this and want to be creative. So let's go. Any Light Will Do. In this tutorial, we're actually going to show you that you can make great images with very, very simple tools. What to think about a tungsten light bulb. The LED panel. A ring light. Your standard flashlight. The Fresnel. The Westcott Ice Light. Smartphones, BloomCube, the chandelier, Christmas lights, we call them light snakes over here. This is one of the most creative lighting videos I ever created. I'm very enthusiastic about it. It's available now via our website. See the links. Hey guys, welcome in the Netherlands, Amsterdam. This is my home country and my name is Frank Doroff. Working with models, that's what I love to do. That's where my main passion is. Working with models gives you the option to create something amazing. I try to really dig in deeper. And to dig in deeper, you have to make sure that your model is at ease. How do you pose your model? How do you style your model? How do you make sure that your image really tells that story? If you want to know more about working with models, check out my class on coaching and working with models on kelby1.com. Okay, now one of the things that I have to make perfectly clear before we're going to do this segment, I'm going to use a light source that we all own, we all have. Now, recently during a workshop, I actually showed this with 4 or 5 of those light sources. And I told the guys, you can do it with any light source at all. It doesn't have to be expensive. And somebody pointed out to me that the light source I was using was actually 800 euros. And he was absolutely right. Yeah, so don't flame me for this. But you can do it with any light source. And the light source I'm going to use now is very expensive. But because we already have that light source, you know what I mean, right? Okay, so let's switch over to Claudia again, and then we're going to switch over the cameras, of course. So let's go to camera 3, and there we have Claudia with a beautiful pole right in front of her face. So we're going to take that one out very quickly, and then it should be okay. There we go. So, okay, so we change lenses also very quickly. And let me just get the sun hood on, because we really need the sun hood for today. And take the lens cap off. Okay, this lens should do a lot better. Okay, so what light source am I talking about? Actually, I'm talking about your smartphone. Yes, or your dumb phone, depending on if you have an Apple or Android. And I'm not going to say which one is the smart one. Hey, Annemiek. We have a house where we have half Apple, half Android. And the thing is, I got everything into Apple, and then I switched myself to Android, so, yeah. Believe Frank, always. So, there we go. Halloween lighting, awesome. Okay, Hans, can you, when I have my camera, can you turn off the main light? Okay, very, very dark. Awesomeness, right? Can you lean against the back? Okay, let's just do it from a distance. And let's just show you how ugly it can be. Okay, So this is very flat lighting again. It's not that nice, it's not that perfect, it's actually very, very boring. But the cool thing about this light is now I can actually also use it for some more interesting shots. Well, my model hates me for this, because it's very, very bright. But you can even do it like from the top down, or maybe a little bit more flat, like straight on camera. And as you can see here, you can get the most beautiful, weird lighting setups. And even Halloween lighting, if you really like it. Can you look down and just scream? One, two, three, go. There we go. Vampires, the new series on Netflix. Coming soon. I actually like it. I don't know why. But you can also do it straight from the top down. And get that really, I don't know how to call this look, except very, very ugly. And this is the thing, right? Let me just light myself for now. There we go. Beautiful Rembrandt lighting. If I hadn't a big nose. So what you can actually see is that by using that light source from your phone, you get a lot more creativity because now you can move around your model and, for example, do some very, very cool lens flare effects. So how about this? You just make sure that the light is in the frame. You get a little bit more like this. Or if you want to do it from a really lower angle, oops, don't go to the camera because then my light will go off. There we go. Do it really light. Oh, low. Sorry. And maybe get the light in. Claudia, do you hate me now or is it okay? Your face tells me enough. So almost the split lighting, it's just absolutely cool. And when I take it out, as you can see here, all the magic is gone. So make sure you keep that light in. Now this is of course not a lot of light. I'm shooting ISO 2000, which actually isn't that bad. Oh, that's nice. That's really nice. And the closer you get, can you close your eyes, please? Keep it closed. You get some really funky looks. Now the reason I'm asking my model to keep her eyes closed, because this is really annoying if she would open up her eyes. And this is just, there's no other light source, guys. There's no other light source. It's just my phone, nothing more. Okay, one more. Chin up a little bit. Or you just move your light down. There we go. Make sure that it's in the frame. Ooh, this is cool. I'm discovering something new. There we go. So now I can literally just make that light only from one side. And when I want that mask in, it's a little bit difficult because I'm right-handed. So now I have to do it over my hand. This is called the professional maneuver. So this is for amateurs. This is for professionals. Amateur, professional. So if you want to look professional, just use strobes. Okay, let me see if I can get that lens flare in again a little bit. There we go. This is awesome. Oh, very nice. And maybe a little bit more to the side. Nice. Okay, let's see what we can do with these images in Photoshop. But first, what do we have to shoot? Different light source, color checker. So, Annemie, can you give me the color checker, please? It's over there. Thank you. But first, we're going to do another light source. I forget something. Don't worry. Okay, can you hold this in front of your face? Close your eyes. Okay, thank you. Annemie, can you give me the ice light? Okay, can you turn on the LED panel again, Hans? Thank you. And, oh, my, I don't have any more hands. Yeah, the ice light there first. Thank you. That was Dutch. Let me just get away my phone. There we go. Okay, so we changed light sources. Now, this is a light source that needs a little bit of explaining. Now, Westcott, actually, our friend Jerome, Jerome-ish? Anyway, the guy that invented it. I always have trouble with his name. He's a really cool guy. So at first, they sent me it without the barn doors. And they asked me, like, do you like it? And I had to be totally honest with him. I said, there is a market for it, without any doubt, because these lights are incredibly popular, but not for me. And then Jerry actually told me on a trade show, I said, oh, didn't they send you the barn doors? No. They sent me barn doors. That changed it completely. So when we turn off the light again, sorry Hans, I have an assistant today and I'm really making him work. Let me see, on. Okay, there we go. Let's turn it on the brightest setting because I love to annoy Claudia. So when I use it like this, it's awesome for certain things. It's absolutely not bad. It's ISO 500, and I'm from a very, very far distance, and I'm getting really cool shots. But, you know, for me, this isn't really what I like, not really what I want. So what I'm doing is I'm actually, and I hope you guys can see it, use the barn doors. And this will actually mean that I limit my light incredibly, because I'm actually doing it even more. There we go. It's just a shiver of light. And now comes the cool part, because now from my distance, I can literally create some really stunning lighting effects. And it's all in the barn door. An ice light without barn doors, not my favorite thing. But with barn doors, oh my, I really love this. Look at this. And if you're more like a conventional person, you can also do it like this. And maybe a little bit more like this. Or maybe like this. So now you have a little bit more leeway, is that the correct term? A little bit more to work with. But if you really make it tight, and you get really close to your model, this is so cool. A little bit more on her mouth. There we go. I'm too close. Sorry, Claudia. There we go. Okay, now we go into Photoshop after we shot the color checker. Because this, again, is a different light source, different color. So every time you use something that has different color or different modification, use a color checker. Are there any questions, Annemiek? That's cool. No questions. Or that's not cool. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, let's dive into Photoshop. And then after that, we're going to do another set. We're really going fast today. Okay. Oh, that monitor is indeed totally black. Okay, there we go. Okay, first things first. Color checker, color balance, copy this. And actually, I love the way before the color checker, but let's make it official. Okay, adjustments, copy and apply. Okay, do the same thing here. Now, normally I tell people shoot the color checker before the shoot. So first image is the color checker. The reason is when you forget it, you can also do it in the last image. But in this case, we're just going to do it like this, because I don't forget, normally. Okay. Adjustments, copy and apply. Okay, so now we have everything correctly color-wise. So no, 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 no. This lens is a lot sharper, as you can see. This was also shot on 1.4. And this is much, much better. Oh, this one. I'm going to give a special treatment to this one. This is terrible. No, I don't like the expression. No. It's okay. Now, these are more... Now, normally, of course, you guys have to work a lot more on your posing, on your storytelling. This is a digital classroom, and somebody emailed me a while ago, like, Frank, I like your work, I like your images, I really like them, but you should take more care about your posing your models and about those little details. And I actually explained to him, I said, do realize that when I shoot, 99% of everything you see in my portfolio or you see online was shot during workshops. It's not to be like, hey, look what I can do. But the difficulty level is really, really high because one, I have to explain everything to the students or during a live shoot. I have to be fast because I can't take time to take my images. Let's say if I want to take 10 minutes, in 10 minutes I can make a great shot. I only have two or three. So everything you see online from me is actually shot during those workshops in 2 or 3 minutes. So be gentle when you look at stuff like this. This is a live stream. I don't have the time to do it really intense. Now, just to give you an idea, the sliver, you know what I mean. The part which is out of focus. Look at how on 1.4. And this is even a 35 mil. So some people claim like they need a 1.285 mil. You don't need a 1.285 mil. Because this is a 35 mil 1.4 and there's hardly any, well, depth of field left. So when you go to 85 1.2, although it's a really cool lens to have, of course. Okay, let me see which images I like. I think this one really tells a story. I really like this. So let's give this one 5 stars. And now we went to the ice light. And the ice light, as you can see immediately, like the smartphone, it's a really small light source. It's really, really harsh on our model. It's great, but it's really harsh. Now, as soon as you go to the ice light, look at how soft the quality is. It's just stunning. So I really like that light source. But for me, it was a little bit too one-dimensional. And as soon as I put on that barn door, I really, really started to like it. So 5 stars. Let's see, this one is cool. This is a little bit too much. Okay, so let's go to my 5s. Okay, so first off this one, and I told you guys we're gonna do something special with this, and we are. You know that I love old horror movies, right? I love those 70s, 80s horror movies. So what I'm gonna do, it's a little bit overexposed, and normally I don't, let me put it this way. Normally I'm really angry at myself when I overexpose a shot. Because I use light meters. In this case, I didn't use a light meter and this was very spontaneous, so I am allowed to do a little bit of this. Okay, I see a question coming in, by the way. Jan and Janine Photography. No questions, just throw away all those Hensel strobes. Let me guess, you will be outside and picking them up, right? We will throw them out in 1, 2, 3. You were not there, sorry you missed it. Now, you know, the cool thing is, and I think it's cool to address this, I love shooting with strobes. I absolutely love it. The reason we're doing digital classrooms like this is because I know a lot of people don't, let me put it this way. They have a camera, they would love to do model photography, but they don't do model photography because, but, there's always this excuse. And I know the same thing, and Annemiek is now sitting next to me, so it's a little bit of a... Annemiek, can you please close your ears for a second?
Yes.
Okay, so this is just between you and me, just you and me. All the other viewers, just don't listen, right? I love playing music, but one of the things that I love even more is recording music. I have my own home studio, and I just love it. But there's this one little thing that always keeps me from recording that hit song, and that's, I really need a different mixer. I really need a light. I really need this. And I buy all this stuff. And at this point, I have a recording studio, which is absolutely awesome for a home studio. But there's always that little bit of an excuse. But when I have this mixer, I can do it even better. When I have this input, and it's all crap. Because nowadays, you can just put your guitar straight into a DAW, digital recording workstation, and you can just record. But people will always put off what they're a little bit afraid for. And for me, that's playing guitar. I'm a little bit afraid of recording it because then people can listen to it. And when I play myself, it's awesome. But when I record it, it becomes something that will never go away. It's stuck there in history. It's on YouTube. It's on whatever. And you don't want that. So there's always this excuse. If I have other strings, if I have another guitar, oh, for this rhythm part, I need this. And you always keep postponing it. And the same thing happens with model photographers. I don't have lighting, I don't have this. And this is the reason we do this kind of digital classroom sometimes, showing you that you can do it with light bulbs. Very, very simple, very, very direct. Okay. Jen and Janine says, no, I'm just kidding. I already own a lot of Hensels and more is on the way. Awesome, love it. Hensel's great product. Okay, let's look at this one. I do the same thing here, just hit those highlights just a little bit of shadow detail. Now with this one, and immediately you see the difference when I go to the ice light, which is a softer light quality, I don't feel the need to pull down the highlights, no. Maybe shadows. Maybe a little bit of shadow to open up the dress. Here I actually think I actually need more contrast. So let me see. Oh yeah, look at this, wow. And a little bit of shadow detail now. Because with contrast, you of course destroy a little bit of the shadow detail. No. Okay. So let's first take this one. And this is going to go really fast, guys. So don't worry. Don't think we're going to spend hours in Photoshop. I love Photoshop to death. I really, really do. But I would rather spend my time differently. Okay, so again, I'm not going to do any skin retouching because her skin is actually pretty good. So what we're going to do is go into exposure software. And for this, I want that old-fashioned horror look. Now, you might say, okay, old-fashioned horror look, black and white, right? Universal monsters. So when you go to black and white, you can immediately see what I mean. Yes, awesome. But in all honesty, when I think about old horror movies, the posters were often in color. So I want something in color, but I want that really old looking. And one of the things that you see in those pictures a lot, at least in my memory, is that there's some red tints in, and it's a little bit of a pop art look. So it's almost over the top. And think about those 70s posters like Luci Fulci or Dario Argento. Or I hope I didn't butcher that name. But you know what I mean, right? So let me see if I have something like that in my preset pack. And I probably do, but there's so many presets in there. Oh, look at this. There we go. I already called this WS poster effect, but the thing that I don't like in this case is the overlay. So let's take the overlay out. There we go. Okay, before and after, it's not strong enough. Let's go a little bit more down. By the way, if you buy my preset pack, it's, I believe, 15 euros. And you get all these presets you see me scrolling through now, and a lot more, because you don't see half of it. And let me show you very quickly where you can get those presets. Now, this is a little bit of upselling, of course. So we're not going to do that long. There you go. You wrote it down. Or you already surfed there and ordered it, of course. Okay, let me see. Now, in all honesty, this is a part where I spent a lot of time normally. I'm going to do it slightly faster now for you guys. But this is literally one of the most important parts of my photo shoot, because this is where my image actually gets the look that I like. And in this case, I don't like any of them. So I'm still going to go for that first one that I got in. There we go. I'm going to fine tune this. I don't want to spend too much time in this. Oops. Okay, add a little bit of contrast. There we go. This is pretty awesome. And now I just put the saturation down and I'm only going to do the reds. Sorry, that's you. That's my bad. Let's do the saturation only. There we go. Look at that. And everything else, I'm going to put even more down. I'm not going to do selective coloring, but something that comes close. I really want that skin to be really, really light. And maybe at the luminance. Down, down. There we go. Awesome. Okay, a little bit more saturation. There we go, almost blood red. Awesome. This image, by the way, I'm also going to do in a black and white. I'm going to show you that in a second. But first this. Okay, layer, flatten image. I see that the focus is on the other eye. Yeah, I'm not perfect. Far from. Okay. If there are any questions, feel free. I see a remark like, gear is just a tool, all you need is creativity. You got it, Josh. That's 100% the whole idea of this broadcast. Siri. Now, do you know that the time when you listen to a podcast and they talk about Google Home in the car, and I have Android Auto on, I literally don't ever do that. When you have a podcast or YouTube video, don't say, Google, you know what I mean, right? In the car, every 5 seconds, because they were telling about all the nice things they could make Google do. When you do a podcast like that, people are going to listen that use Google. So don't do the Google. No. Just say, okay, so now you say the sentence and you say this command and this will happen. It drove me freaking nuts. Okay, flatten image and file close. And in Capture One, we're going to do the black and white. So let's do this. Okay, let's go back to, I'm not going to do them all, but just this one and maybe the other one. Because I want to show you the last one also. Okay, this one is very, very simple, only tinting. Her skin is okay, but not good enough. And that's because I know my model. And let's go ultra smooth. This is an action I wrote. It's very, very simple. And if you saw more digital classrooms, you already know. It's just a duplicate current layer. Run image nomic portraiture and just make a mask. And image nomic portraiture is a software package. It's not cheap, but it's without a doubt one of my favorite software packages. It's really, really good for skin. An alternative, if you don't want to shelf out 200 euros, I believe it is, get Topaz, and then Topaz Clean. Topaz Clean is awesome. You can't run it in batch like you can with ImageNomic, but it's worth every single cent. It's absolutely awesome. Okay, so let's make the brush a little bit smaller. Oh, by the way, guys, if you don't see your brush like I see now, don't panic. It's the caps lock. So put the caps lock. There you go. First time it just drove me nuts. I was looking for hours and then I found out that my caps lock was on. Yep. Okay. Now it is on the nuclear setting, so that means that it's on a very, very high aggressive setting, but I'm only using my brush with a very low opacity. And as if it, I don't know if you can hear, I'm actually building up the effect now. So I don't want it even everywhere. I just want some places to be more skin smoothened and some places to be less. And by hitting it a few more times, I will actually add to the effect. You can also solve this by doing pressure sensitivity on your brush. But in my case, I'm just going to do it like this. Okay, much better. However, you can still see that there's a little bit of discoloration there. You can do that with the clone tool. But what I normally do is I run again image nomic portraiture on the highest setting. And I'm only going to take out those parts. And this I'm going to do on 100%. And it's really this part that annoys me. There you go. Now I'm using my pressure sensitivity. There we go. Okay, now it's a little bit too much on her mask. So just make the brush smaller and just paint back in the mask. Now normally I do this way nicer, of course, but for live broadcast, we're just going to do it a little bit faster. Okay, let's go before, after. Pretty cool. Going to add a little bit of noise later on to mask it even better, and then we're fine. Okay, go to exposure software and just take the look. And normally I always say to people, take the same look in that same set. In this case, we're not going to do that. Oh, I like this. Look at the reds. Wow. Oh, this is better. Little bit of blue in the shadows. And again, these preset packs, you get exactly the same presets that you see me using now. I don't believe in light packages or that I use something else myself. Actually, we always update the preset packs without telling you guys. So when you buy something, you're actually buying the new preset pack. Let me see. Little bit of grain. That's too much. And the thing is, I always take it out of the shadows, the grain, and I leave it in the midtones a little bit lower, and the highlights, I actually pump it up. The reason for this is when I leave it in the shadows, it looks like you're using a camera that is not so sensitive for light. In other words, it has a lot of noise. When you take it out of the shadows and you only put it in the highlights, you get this really funky artist look. And on the monitor and on YouTube, you won't see this. But when you have a print that's really big, like an A0, so that's the biggest print, you really see those really fine lines, and it's absolutely awesome. Okay, so let's see. I don't want any color variation, so let's pull that down. I want a little bit of post-processing, but not too much. And we're done. And apply. And that's one of the things that, again, in Photoshop you can emulate this all, but when you have it in a plugin, it's just so much easier, man. It's just easier. Okay. Anyway, are there any questions on Facebook?
No.
Okay.
Well, just one question about have you ever used two ice lights?
Have I ever used two ice lights? I think that will drive me bankrupt. Because those things are pretty expensive. No, I never used two ice lights, but I would love to try. Because for the next set, we're actually going to use a LED tube. Oh, I love it. The red almost just bleeds off the screen, especially on the BenQ. So let's just lower it a little bit.
So I told him to bring his own ice light to the next workshop.
Oh, okay.
And
cool.
Then you can try.
Awesome. Okay, flatten image and file close. I just love those backdrops, by the way. They're really, really nice. Every time Anuweek selects a new backdrop for me, because as I told you, we are the distributor and importer for these backdrops. And they always, she always chooses backdrops that I normally don't use. And sometimes when I see the backdrops, I go like, yeah, thank you very much, Anuweek. And then I start shooting it, and it's like, thank you very much, Anuweek. They're absolutely awesome. And that's one of the things that I want to stress with you guys. If you want to be creative, and you always know blacks works, go for white. If you know yellow is your color, it always works, go for red. If you know green is the most terrible color ever, go for green and try to create something really cool with green, because if you can pull that off, you can do anything. Okay, now this one I want to show you something different. Let's first look at the skin. And I think the skin looks okay again. Oh, yeah, don't look at 100% in this case, guys. Sorry, I messed this one up. So for this one, I want to add a little bit of structure here. And there's this plugin. And again, we're going to go for the plugins. And it's called Topaz Studio 2. And in the old studio, there was a free version that could do anything, but you need to do presets that you find online. This version, I don't think you can do presets online anymore. But it's well worth your investment. It's a really, really cool software package. Where is it? Oh, there we go. Sorry, I have to drag it to this monitor. Okay, there we go. Great. Now, what I do here is I will add a look, and it's called Pop. As you can see, it has a little bit of a, it's rendering now, that little bit of a contrasty look. Now, in this case, I have to be very, very careful because this was high ISO. So it means that now everything is enhanced a lot. So you get a lot of noise extra, but also a lot of detail. So in Photoshop, so I'm now rendering this. I want to see what I can use from this. So this is absolutely horrendous. You don't want to use this. So go for layer, layer mask, hide all. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a brush with white paint and I'm going to put it on 50%. And I'm only going to go over the dress, as you can see here. Now, what you will see happening on YouTube probably even is that it just gives a little bit of extra sharpness. I do the same thing over the face and a little bit under here. There we go. So I hope you can see this on YouTube. It seems like it just gives you a little bit of a lift. And when you see it on the monitor here, it enhances that sharpness a lot. This is one of the killer filters you will see on almost all my images. And it's the look where people often go like, how do you get that sharpness in? And that's actually Topaz Studio. Okay, let me see. Trevor, have you done any courses on accurate color production in printing? You spend so much time on color and it doesn't always print right. Yeah, well, you know the problem with printing is you need a profile for your printer. Now, X-Rite has a really cool product out there that will actually calibrate your monitor. Of course, your camera with color checker passport, but also your printer. Now, for your printer, you don't use an analyzer like this. This is the new iDisplay Plus. So this is a really cool one. If you are in the market for an analyzer, make sure you get this one. Let me show you the box very fast. So this is highly recommended by Frank Doroff. Oh, okay. Highly recommended by me. This is an absolutely awesome analyzer. Great software also, especially the new Profiler 3 software. It's amazing. It's 64 bits also. Some people ask me about it. Hey, did you know that X-Rite only does 32 bits? No, they do 64 bits. And even if you have an older analyzer like the i1 Pro, make sure you download the newest software that works under all the versions in 64 bits. So i1 Display Pro Plus. The thing that you do for your printer is you use a spectrometer. A spectrometer is a totally different device. Now, when you look at an analyzer like this, there are gels inside, often glass gels. And those gels are for red, green, and blue, and often also some other colors, depending on which brand you use. Those glass filters only get a little bit of the spectrum. In a normal monitor, that can be a problem. On an Adobe RGB monitor, like the BenQs or ISO, whatever brand you use, I, of course, love BenQ. Those monitors are already very, very good. So when you use an analyzer like this, that spectrum of red, let's say red is here, the spectrum on the analyzer is like this. So it will fit in perfectly. But if you have a monitor, let's say a crap laptop, a really old laptop, it can be that red's supposed to be there, but it's more shifted towards orange. Now, when you use an analyzer that has a gel that fits here, and your red is shifted a little bit towards orange, that part will fall off. So it won't be registered. What a spectrometer does is actually when you look at your your histogram, that's what a spectrometer does. It reads the whole spectrum. There are no filters inside that will pinpoint certain areas. It just reads the whole spectrum. And that's what you need for your printer. Now, you need a special spectrometer for your printer. You need one that is able to put it on paper and still read it. So you need something with a light in there. Correct. Now, when you do this, you have to remember that your print is not the printer. You're not profiling your printer. A lot of people get that wrong. You don't profile your printer. What you do is you profile your paper and your ink. Actually, you're profiling your printer. But you're using the same ink over and over, so that means that the profile is for the ink and for the paper. Whenever you switch to another paper, you have to do the whole profiling again, and trust me, it's a lot of work. So what I normally do is I use the Epson Premium Gloss Paper, and I use the Premium Luster Pro Profile from Epson. Now, just email me if you have an Epson printer and your prints are always too muddy. There's one section, and on some computers that happen, that you have to change a little bit, and then your prints will come out just fine. There's another thing. It may look great outside. Now, you walk inside, you hold it next to your monitor, and you go like, what the heck happened? It looks totally different. That's correct. Your monitor, you always have to remember, your monitor emits light, paper absorbs light. And it means that inside you can never ever judge paper on the right way. You need lighting on that paper. I dare you, walk outside with the print you don't like and you're gonna love that print because now it's hitting with the correct lighting, full spectrum lighting, and you will love that print. Now, when you have a client, and this is where it gets tricky, Pantone, it's part of X-Rite, I believe, but Pantone has a little sticker, and that sticker has two squares. If you have a client that complains that your print doesn't look right, and you know for certain that print looks right, get one of those stickers and put it on the back of that print. Now, ask your client, can you turn around the print? What do you see? If the client says, I see two squares, you know it's wrong. Go outside. How many squares do you see now? And he will probably, or she will probably say, I now see one. Now it's on the correct lighting. Turn the print around. Do you like the print? Yeah, man, I love the print. Go back inside. Do you see the difference? Yes, get proper lighting. Those Pantone things, I don't know what they're called. If you want to know, just email me and we'll email you the, or we'll put it in the description below. Anyway, can you put it in the description below? What? For the Pantone?
The sticker?
The sticker from Pantone. Yeah, and we're just going to put it in the description below. Those stickers are really awesome because then it takes away, you know, you don't want to argue with a client. The client is always right. Client is king, right? But by putting that sticker on, you actually put him totally out of the game. Do you see two squares? Yes. Okay, my print is right. So that's the trick. And when you use print services, don't even start me on that one. Just use their profiling. Put it there on sRGB, so not Adobe RGB. Put it there in JPEGs and just pray, because often it doesn't work right. Okay, let me see. That's a good point about looking at prints in ambient light. Okay, yes, ambient light, never for prints. Okay, so we've done skin. Let me do this really fast, guys, because then we're going to do the next set. Okay. You see, I don't zoom in 100%. Of course, normally you zoom in 100%. In this case, because it's a live broadcast, I am a little bit more sloppy. I zoom in 100% to check something. Okay, I needed to go 100% indeed. And again, this is shot on 1.4. Don't mind the focus, because I seem to be selecting all the images today that are a little bit out of focus. It's one of those days. That's totally my fault, by the way. Don't worry. I know the camera and the lens can be pin sharp at 1.4. But during live broadcasts, we always worry a little bit about audio and everything else. That makes me a little bit more sloppy. Okay. Now, if you want to see what you've done and if you hit all the right parts, it's a very simple trick. And somebody told me that trick. I didn't know it. I don't know everything, of course. Oh, let me do this one. And before you know it, I still do a proper retouch, but hey. And
Stop. You need to go back, Frank. The camera is not good.
Oh, sorry. Ah, okay, that's dumb. You should watch the cameras in a week. So, there we go. Okay. Sorry, guys.
I was working on the Pantone thing.
Yeah, don't do that. Do that later. Okay, let me see. Okay, so this looks okay. Okay, let's go to view, fit on screen. Okay, better. Just pull it down just a little bit to give the original skin back. Okay. And again, here, go to your favorite tinting program. In my case, it's again, of course, Exposure Software. And in the meantime, they're setting up for the next set. That's why I'm stalling a little bit. Oh, I love this. Really nice. It's maybe a little bit too aggressive, but you can never be too aggressive with this kind of stuff. Black and white is also cool. But I think I'm actually going to go for this. Normally during the workshops, I always let my students choose, but in this case, because we're online, I can't do that. I let them choose and I change it later, so don't worry. Yep, I love this one. Okay, awesome. Just a little bit of shift. It doesn't have to be a lot, but I just wanted a little bit. Now, with an image like this, there's a lot of red in the image, and there's one really, really cool trick. Again, when you look at images, it's always three channels, red, green, and blue, because red, green, and blue are the primary colors. The secondary colors are cyan, magenta, and yellow. All these colors are connected to each other. So when you use paints, for example, you don't use RGB or cyan, magenta, and yellow. You actually use a combination. I just forgot about that, but I mean, I forgot about what the combination was where you paint with, but sometimes when you put primary colors together, you get this really nasty brown. And when you use part secondary and part primary colors, that's kindergarten stuff, and I forgot about that. Sorry, guys. So, flatten image. Okay, now the trick is when you use channels, is actually when you see that there's a lot of red, this one can work. It can work. It isn't a promise. So, make a new empty layer, and there's nothing in there. Make sure you are on the active background layer, so make sure you switch it. Go for channels and go for red. Control A to select everything, Control C to copy everything. Now go back to RGB, go to layers, now go to your top layer and do Control V, copy. Now what you have is a black and white copy according to some people. This is not a black and white copy. This is actually the red channel. And what you're going to do now is you're going to mix that red channel with the rest. And look at the contrast you get. Wow. This is really, really nice. Go from zero and build it up to hero, to where you want to be. There you go. Absolutely love it. And it's, again, it's very, very subtle. But you know, in those subtle differences, that's where the difference is between a photographer, somebody that creates arts, and a real photographer. I'm just a photographer. I just love to play with this kind of stuff. So layer, flatten image, and we're done. And we're going to go for the next set. But before that, I'm going to show you that black and white conversion I was telling you about. Okay. And then later on, I'm going to retouch that one. Okay, so here we have that black and white conversion. Now, first I have to go to where my images are. Output location. Okay. Awesome. And here we have that black and white. So what I want to do is I want to create a new variant. So I'm going to do new variant, and I'm going to go to my plugins section, my user styles. I'm going to go for black and white, and this one I just want in black and white, but I also want it in color, so that's why I didn't do only black and white. Oh wow, one moment, this is also very cool. Let me switch over. Which one do I like more? Yeah, the original. Okay, so let's deselect this one. That's too much. Old-fashioned with grain. There we go. Look at this. And now the backdrop is almost like, it's almost like a mist behind it. Like really, really evil. Love it. A little bit of contrast. Highlights, protecting. Nope. Just let it blow out. A little bit of shadow detail. And there we go. Love it. Okay. So let's go back. And let's go for the next set. But first, I want to show you guys why it's important to use a light meter. Because we have a little bit of a break.
Hey guys, my name is Frank Dorof and I'm the author of the book Mastering the Model Shoot. Now, you guys really like the book because we're getting a lot of rave reviews on Amazon and every other online store. So that actually triggered us to make a video series about the book. Now, in the first video, I will tell you everything about the light meter. Now, in digital photography, I think the light meter is the one thing that confuses people a lot. Shouldn't I use the histogram, Frank? Isn't there a meter inside the camera? Where do I point the meter? Towards the pretty girl? Towards the camera? Towards the light source? Where? There's a lot of confusion out there. Now, in this video, I will give you in more than 70 minutes all the insights out about the light meter. Calibrating, using incident and reflective, using a white background, how to keep details in the black, how to trigger the meter, where to point the meter. You will see everything very easily explained, but you will also see photo shoots, including our model Manon. This is one of the videos if you're slightly interested in the light meter, or if you already have a light meter and you want to know everything about it, get this video. It's called Mastering the Model Shoot, the Light Meter, and it's the first video in a whole series that we're going to release in connection to our book Mastering the Model Shoot, and it's available now from our website. Without a doubt, one of the most beautiful places in the world for street photography. In this video, Beyond Snaps New York, we're not only gonna show you tips and tricks about gear, getting great shots, locations, how to talk to people, and much, much more, but we're also gonna show you some places that you may or may not have heard of New York. How about two Chinatowns? You probably know one. We actually found another one that's way more interesting. How about a location where you can get great, great night shots? Or Jay and Silent Bob's secret stash, Amityville. This video is jam-packed with not only photography tips and techniques, but also great locations to visit when you go to the New York area. I'm sure you're gonna enjoy this video. In my opinion, it's one of the best we ever made. So enjoy Beyond Snaps to New York.
Okay, and we're back. Hey guys, so today, all about alternative light sources. For the last one, I actually do it slightly different. These light sources I'm going to use, are, the first one is very, very cheap. You can buy them on eBay or Marktplaats or Craigslist or whatever you want to buy them. They're called chandeliers, and we have a lot of them in the studio. I think we have about four or five. I always buy them. And the thing is, they have a lot of lighting, so that means you have four lights that are actually 100 watts. And it emits a lot of light, but you can also use it as a prop. Now, in this case, we choose a very, very simple one because I want to show you something where we actually gonna mix some light in. Now, the second thing I'm gonna take is expensive. It's a LETGO LED tube. And the cool thing about this LED tube is it's a big investment, but it's worth every single cent. One, it emits an immense amount of light. It can't compete with a strobe. But trust me, it blows away any tungsten light source. And you can take any color you like. It's literally, I don't know if it's any color, but let me put it this way. It's almost any color in the spectrum. Plus, if you have video, there's a candle mode where it flickers a little bit. There's a police mode where you have red and blue. You have a storm mode, a lightning mode, whatever. So for video, guys, this thing is awesome. Again, they're not cheap, but trust me, they're so cool to work with. So we're going to start out with the chandelier, and then we're going to use the LED lamp extra. It could be that I need a little bit of help, but we're just going to wing it. So we're just going to see what happens. Okay, so let's switch over to our studio again. So picture in picture, there we go. And now you're gonna see her for the first time in her new clothing. One, two, three. Oh, that are all my strobes. I'm just kidding with you guys. There you go, and there you go. Okay, so let's see what we can do. Okay, so first things first, we have a chandelier. It's on the floor now. I'm gonna ask my model actually to pick it up. Yes. And we have another backdrop. This is our decay backdrop, Annemiek. Okay. Let me see that we... Yeah, we're gonna turn on the back for a second. There we go. Oh, that LED, yes. That one has to be turned off. Okay, can you move a little bit that way? You look stunning. Perfect. Okay, just look a little bit down towards the light. Okay, there we go. Now, this is a little bit too much. I'm actually going to lower my exposure compensation. Awesome. Love it. Nice. Look a little bit more that way. Let me just go to 2.8 because I have so much light now. Okay, let's go to -2 on my exposure compensation. That's nice. Love it. Chin down just a little bit. Is it heavy or is it okay? Is it heavy or is it okay?
It's okay.
Okay, cool. You can live with it. Okay, let's do a lower angle. Okay, so this is pretty okay. It's way too red, of course, but we have to change that later. So now we're going to add a little bit of color. And I have this LED tube. So let me just pick this up and just show you guys what it is. This is the LEDCO LED tube. And I can literally just cycle to all the colors. So first of all, let me go to the dimmer. Let me go to 100%. And then just go to saturation. So I can change my saturation. So I go for example, wider or lower. And that's not all. You can also go to HSI. And I can literally just scroll to all the colors, as you can see here. And I have, let me see how many I have. We start at 0. And you can go all the way up to 360. So we have 360 different colors. In all honesty, when you go from 360 to 350, you can already see differences. So this gives you so much power. And I want a little bit of a magenta look in this. So I don't want red. I'm just going to go down just a little bit towards magenta. Now, of course, you can use an assistant that holds this tube. But what you can also do is if you're a little bit more lazy or you don't have an assistant, because it's so bright, you just place it there and you just hope it don't fall, doesn't fall.
I hope so too.
Yeah, I think LEDCO hopes so too. And we just give it a little bit of a hinge on the side of my model. But of course, this is way too little, as you can see here. You hardly see it. It just opens up the shadows a little bit. So what I'm going to do is, Annemiek, are you needed behind the desk? Yes. Okay, the Hans. If you can hold the LED light a little bit closer towards my model, just open up the shadows from the side, and especially on the face, so from top down. There we go. Now, in all honesty, this is a very expensive solution. But this was a low-budget digital classroom. You can, of course, use any sort of light that just gives you colors. Or you just use filters. Or whatever you want to use. As long as it just emits light and it has a color, everything is possible. Look at this. Yes? I know, now color will be corrected later. Don't worry. Don't worry. Okay? Nice. Love this. Okay, let's twist it around. Give me this. And let's put this one. Let me see. Annemiek, can I have a chair? Annemiek is running. Put the camera on Annemiek. Just put the chair there. Okay, we're going to put the lighting on here. I just want to open up the shadows a little bit. Yes. Great. Now, that's going to be your main light. So look there. First, totally pink, as you can see here. And now, why I needed the chair is I don't want to lift it up from the floor. I'm actually going to use it next to my hand. I'm going to use split lighting. And if I move it closer, I get more light. Oh, sorry. This is awesome. I love it. Okay, one more. Thank you. Awesome. Thank you very much. Okay, let's see what we can do with these in Photoshop for the final part. Oh, one moment. Color checker. And then we need to turn that one off. Because the color checker, we really have to shoot without the colored light. Anyway, where did you put the color checker? Okay, guys, panic, where's the color checker?
Here.
Ah, there you have it.
That's why you put a sticker on it.
Yeah, that's why we put stickers on it. Yeah. Okay. I'm just going to take the chandelier. There we go. Is that okay? Yeah, it smells a little bit, but that's fear. And that one can be turned off. Okay, awesome. Oops. Let's switch over. Okay, so somebody already said, hey Frank, it's a little bit dark. Yes, that's what I explained. There's no light there. Okay, and somebody said, well, the colors aren't right. Correct too. So let's do this. So now the color is corrected. But in all honesty, don't you just love that color, you? But let's for now forget this. Forget that you love this, which I do. So let's make everything neutral. Adjustments, copy and apply. Now the first thing you will notice, it takes away a little bit of the magic. So before we had this really nice, oh, sorry guys, Anouk. Okay, sorry guys, let's reset this. Adjustments, reset. For all images, of course. And I'm going to show it again. Okay, so of course we love this look, but let's forget for now that we love this look. So let's make it neutral. So we're going to make this neutral. Awesome. Let's select everything. And this is the reason why I do this way. Okay, select everything, adjustments, copy and apply. Now I lost that beautiful, beautiful look. In essence, I'm stuck with something that looks normal. And although sometimes normal is good, in this case, we don't want normal. We want something really interesting. Now, these shots, I can already tell you, I'm not going to retouch because they are nice, but we already shot so many of these shots in the past. But as soon as we start adding that extra light, this is where it gets interesting. Because now you have two colors competing for each other. Now, when you do color balance, it's always the difference, or sorry, the balance between red, green, and blue, those three channels, right? And they're always at the same level, because then you have correct color balance. That's why we use neutral gray, because in neutral gray, all three values are equal. Now, as soon as you put in a color, like a gel, or a light, or tungsten, or if you combine two light sources, you have a real problem in real life. This is why they use CTO gels. Now, a CTO gel, let me switch over to another camera. Okay, so what a CTO gel does is it's actually a color correction gel. So let's say you have strobes that emit 5,000 degrees Kelvin and you have tungsten light that emits 2,800 degrees Kelvin. There's a difference and there's a huge difference. So what you do is you use a color correction gel on your strobes and now your strobes will get a lower color temperature also on 2,800 degrees Kelvin. This is what you normally do. And when you have, for example, fluorescent lights, you use green. When you are outside, you don't use anything. So when we are in the studio, what I sometimes love to do is actually play with that competing battle between the colors. So let me switch back to the split screen. Okay, so these images are already competing a little bit, but as soon as I started moving that light closer, I have on one side the tungsten light, on the other side the magenta light, which already creates a little bit of tension. This reminds me a little bit of those old TV shows like the Munsters or whatever, but the Munsters, of course, were in black and white. So I actually, let me see. I love this one. This is really nice. I see it reminds me a little bit of Wonder Woman in this outfit. This one is very, very magenta, but that's correct because this is, and this is where you see the color balance, right? Because I color balanced on the tungsten light, the magenta now really, really shows up. And the tungsten light is normal. Oh, this one, this is the one. Let me see if there's a better one. I don't think so. Okay, so I already selected my images. Ooh, there we go. Okay, so let's just play with this. Now, again, I'm not going to go into Photoshop. Let's keep it low budget. Let's open this up a little bit. The reason I didn't do this during the photo shoot is if I do this during the photo shoot, what I actually do is I overexpose my light bulbs. And I don't want it. I know that when I underexpose slightly, then in Capture One or Lightroom or whatever RAW converter you use, you can actually now open up with exposure. But because I'm opening up with exposure, I can pull my highlights back and actually dim the lights. You see? So I can turn my lights on and off. Now, when I do this standard, that blowing area where it already is blown out, I can't get back. So I can get it back a little bit, but this is just a way better, just underexpose slightly and then pull back the highlights. It's a better way of working, I think. Okay, so that's one. This one needs actually nothing. Maybe a little bit of contrast. A little bit of shadow detail. And same here, a little bit of exposure. This is the thing when you don't use light meters and you use light, and it doesn't make any sense to use a light meter here because I constantly change over the distance, and when you change the distance, you change your exposure, so you need to do a new light meter reading, and that will drive you totally insane. So don't do that. Okay, now what I can do, and this is a really, really cool trick. As you can see here, we have natural color or semi-natural color, it's corrected, and here we have this really magenta part. Go into your color balance. And what you do is you just change the Kelvins. And you take away a little bit of that magenta. And now you can fine-tune it with your skew, or tint in this case. There you go. And you get this really nice blend of bluish magenta. And the nice thing is, I only used one gel, or in this case, one LED strip. We sometimes do this during workshops, and it always is cool to see how people respond. Because in the workshop, I actually use one red gel, or a blue gel, and one strobe without any gels. And it looks okay, but it doesn't look exciting. Now, as soon as you change that color balance and you start playing with that tint, people go like, oh, it's like you use two gels. Yes, it actually looks like you use two gels. But the main difference is when you use two gels, it's very difficult to keep that skin tone looking, I don't want to say natural, because nobody has blue skin unless you're a Smurf, but anyway, it looks a little bit more natural when you don't use gel and you just use normal lighting and you fix that with your color balance. Okay, now we have to make sure that they are both equal. So adjustments, copy and apply. And in all essence, to be honest, when I do it here, you can see it more extreme. Here it's almost totally blue, so go somewhere in between. And the more bright your LED light will be, the cooler this you can work with. There you go. Now, when you're on location and you're shooting this with gels, one of the main disadvantages of gels is you can't go back. So when you choose a very, very bright blue, very thick blue gel and a very thick red gel, and you put them on your model, in Photoshop, you can't take that away. But when you use a very thick blue or red gel and the other one you don't gel, later on in Photoshop, you can just move it around and you can still use that split toning. But you have way more control this way. I actually like it this way. So let's just crop this a little bit because I think it's a little bit too broad. And there's a lot. Oh, let me show you this. This is a cool trick in Photoshop if you don't know it. Okay, so we have this image and it's absolutely awesome. I love everything about it. I love this one. This one is also cool. But now your client goes like, Frank, I missed part of the backdrop, right? Okay, no problem. We'll fix that for you. Go to Photoshop, Control D, in Lightroom it's Control E. Let me find my pen. Okay, there we go. Okay, so we have this piece missing. Now you can do the clone tool trick, which is a lot of cloning and it will never look right. And you can do another one. And let me do one first. This one is the one that probably most of you guys will use. You just select it with the marquee tool, press delete, use content aware fill, color adaption, and just press OK. And within seconds, you will see that Photoshop, this is 60 megapixels, guys, so this takes a little bit of time. There we go. So this looks pretty convincing, to be honest. Yep, looks great. This is the best method. Now, if you have a backdrop and you go like, I don't want to do it like this, I actually want to do it differently, that's no problem at all. Some people want to do it differently, right? No problem. Take your marquee tool, go as close as possible to the side of your model, but don't touch anything on the model, nothing. Go as close as possible. And now do edit, transform, scale. And you just, oh, sorry, new Photoshop. Hold the shift key and just drag it out. Now, in all honesty, this is the solution which works great for even backdrops or backdrops that have one simple pattern. And the pattern is that you can stretch it. In this case, it doesn't work at all for me. So in this case, we're going to go back. Sorry, escape. Okay, control C, Z, Z. Okay, do a new marquee. And we're going to do content aware fill again. And content-aware fill is just absolutely awesome. And the cool thing about these backdrops, and it seems like I'm promoting the backdrops, and that's not 100% true, it's 99% true. I really love the backdrops for the very simple reason. You can do tricks with this that you can't do on a normal backdrop. And in the past, we used the Lasto lights, which are absolutely awesome. And I love those for exactly the same reason. But you buy so many backdrops where you can't use this trick. And how often does it happen in your studio where you just have a little bit of a black side because the backdrop isn't wide enough or you didn't take any care of your composition and you want to put that in and it doesn't work? The cool thing about these backdrops and of course also the luster lights in that case is that you can actually make them bigger. And this is also why we actually got into these backdrops, because when I put my name on something, I'm really 100% behind it. And it actually started, this is a really cool story, we found them in South Africa where I was doing a trade show. And Charlie actually told me like, man, I really love your work and what you do with your backdrops. And we started talking about my studio and that we have all these special walls in our studio, because when you know our studio a little bit, all our walls are actually lit in different ways. Oh, sorry, are painted in different ways. And at one point I had this idea like, hey, why not take high resolution images, 60 megapixel images of our walls, print it, and now people can have a piece of our studio. So we started up like, hey, you want me in your studio? That's not possible, but you can have a piece of our studio in your studio. And they were totally up for it. So they now have a signature series, and make sure you check out the Opulent Red. In all honesty, this is again between you and me, don't tell anybody about this. The Opulent Red is one of our backdrops that I hardly ever use for the very simple reason I hate that backdrop. I use it myself, but I never use it with attendees of the workshops because it's a highly reflective backdrop. You can light it, but it's a disaster because everything just keeps reflecting back and we use the wrong paint. And it's just so beautiful, but it's difficult to photograph. So what I did is I used several setups. I shot it from different angles to make sure that we didn't get that reflection in. And at one point, by putting them all together, I had the perfect backdrop. I looked at it, was going like, this is the backdrop that I want. And that's the cool thing. Now you can use that Opulent Red backdrop without all the problems with the reflection. So that's the cool thing about having your own backdrops. Anyway, this was what I wanted to tell you guys. Don't be afraid that you don't have strokes. Don't be afraid that your camera is not good enough. You can make great images. And if you have a crappy lens, just make it black and white and nobody will notice. Add a lot of contrast and noise and you have instant art. But overall, I just want to inspire you guys by doing stuff with very, very little means. And I hope that was the message for today. If you have any questions, put them in the comments below. I will actually look at all the comments, of course, tonight and give you answers for everything. If you have an idea for a different digital classroom, just let me know. We'll incorporate that. Maybe the next time it will be about storytelling or something. Yeah. Because Anouk and I did one recently and you guys loved it. So maybe we're going to do something like that about the styling we do in the workshops and then let Anouk have her say in it. First of all, of course, happy holidays for everybody because it's almost Christmas. On January 18, we have a masterclass retouching and shoot yourself with LED lighting in Culemborg. That's, I believe, organized by
Van Duren
and PhotoFact. So
it's in Dutch.
That's in Dutch, but it's on 18 January. If you're in the Netherlands, in Culemborg, make sure you visit that day, because it's not only me, there are a lot of other photographers and retouchers giving you loads and loads of tips. It's really awesome. The next Digital Classroom is January 22. The topic, you tell us. If you have a problem, not mentally, I can't help you with that, not physically, I'm not allowed to do that, maybe, but if you have a problem with photography, let me know and we'll incorporate that into the next Digital Classroom. The thing is, we're also going to do something else. I want you guys to email me info@frankdorhoff.com. Ask me any question you want, because in the next Digital Classroom, we're going to do an interview style. That means I'm going to read your emails and I'm going to answer all the questions. I'm behind the computer, so if you have retouching questions, I'm going to incorporate that. So the next Digital Classroom is made up by you guys. Any problem you have, if it's lighting, we're going to do it in a live shoot. If it's a question, we're going to do it in the Q&A. So it's going to be really, really cool and unique. I've never done that before in all essence. I just made it up now. I see Anouk panicking. Don't worry, it will be okay. That was it for today. I hope you guys enjoyed it. And our question is very, very simple. Please make sure you leave comments below. Hit that like button, because we really like that. Smash it. And hit the bell notification. But most of all, tell other people about our channel so we can grow. And make sure you join our Patreon. Because on Patreon, let me put that down very quickly. On Patreon, starting at $1 a month, you get portfolio reviews from other guys. If you are, I believe, in the $10 range, you also do the portfolio review for you. You can discuss with other people's stuff. You get a lot of backstage images. We're even going to start with 360 images from backstage. So that's going to be interesting. And sometimes we have live streams from our studio. And that's all only for Patreon. And it starts with $1 a month. So if you like what we do, join our Patreon. You are absolutely going to love it. Let me see. Oh, now I see some images coming in. Culemborg is okay. Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to look this back. What a creativity. Visit one of the workshops. You ain't seen nothing yet. Okay, guys. Thank you so very much for watching. See you again next time in the next Digital Classroom. Many, many thanks to BenQ and Rogue for making this possible. Thank you, guys. You are awesome. And see you again next time. Bye, guys.